Hello, welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Life is a matter, they say, of surviving well, living long. But let me say that if you're like my guest, Meryl Joan Gerber, you learn that no matter what, you laugh. Well, her book is called The Hysterectomy Waltz. It's published by DeZank, and welcome, Meryl.
Thank you.
And let me say, this is for a book entitled The Hysterectomy Waltz. It is very funny.
I'm glad I meant it to be. Yes.
Beginning with the fact that as a young kid in Brooklyn, you have a friend, Laura, with an older brother, Jeffrey, who spends his time cooking cats.
He's going to be a doctor.
Yes.
Right, right.
But one says, what sort of a doctor? Mm-hmm. And years later, when you have three daughters and all you want is a son, and you are at a certain age for women, you say, oh, I must be pregnant. I don't have my, what did your mother call it? DC?
Oh, delicate condition.
Yes.
It's the character's mother. Right,
yes.
Right.
But since you write it in the first person, one has to say,
yes.
What is, where is she taking her inspiration?
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
And every writer is asked that. I mean, it's the first question that's asked a writer at any reading, did this happen to you? And the truth is that fiction is a combination of imagination, memory, magic, creation. And it sometimes, once it's written, the writer doesn't really know from where the original aspect came. In other words, the truth disappears, becomes the art.
Well, in this particular book, one hopes things didn't happen to you, mm-hmm. but it begins with the character set going to a GYN mm-hmm. who she thinks is too young. I mean, it's terrible as you get older that your doctors are younger than you are.
Right, right. And I have to say, this book was written 33 years ago. And it was written at a time when all gynecologists, almost all, were male. And there was a kind of attitude toward women who had had children. Well, you've had your children. You don't need all this stuff anymore. We'll take it all out. We'll leave the playground and remove the plumbing. You know, there was some very harsh ideas offered women who had possibly had the need for a hysterectomy in those days. Not only that, there was no internet. There was no access for information. So the two or three books you could find in the library were dated, and you didn't have much knowledge about how to manage your own body.
And in this particular case, she has missed her periods, and she goes to one, and he says, lady, you're not pregnant.
Mm-hmm. He says, this could be cancer.
Yeah.
That's what he says. And throws her whole world into a great distress, and it proceeds from there.
And her only connection with friend Laura is Laura became a doctor, a
right.
female doctor,
mm-hmm.
and she says, well, she's in Beverly Hills, she's made a great success, I'm just sort of Miss Middle Person in the book, and she goes to see Laura, who says, doesn't really acknowledge her as an old friend that much.
Well, she wants to keep Brooklyn in the dark. In other words, she's a Beverly Hills doctor now. Their old history as friends from Brooklyn is less important. You know,
in the past.
The origins are a little too low for the
yeah.
present.
But
life.
She puts her through every exam, and there's one, though, that our friend in the character doesn't go through, which was a mammogram.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And but Laura sends her over to a surgeon. Well, lo and behold, who's the surgeon?
It's her brother, right. It's her brother.
And he doesn't make a connection.
He walks in the room backwards. You see, that's the exaggeration and the satire of the book. Doctors who come in and don't know who you are, they walk in backwards and they check their fancy watch, they check their stocks, and they barely know who you are on the table.
Yeah.
So he doesn't make the connection at all that he's known her in her childhood.
And he also has, I love what you say, six nurses or people, protecting him like an armature.
Yeah, that's right. Well, those were the days. And they were very different medical days from now. Mm-hmm. But they could get away with it.
And he says, okay, I'll see you Tuesday morning. And you don't name the hospital, but it could be one of five.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's one of the older L.A. hospitals. Right.
Which means when you get in their emergency room, which you have to go through to get put in the hospital, waiting. Mm-hmm. I mean, I said to you, at one of the better known here, my husband, who was fairly aged, had to wait 10 hours to get into just an emergency room.
It's unendurable, really, yeah. The way medicine is run today. And I've had that experience recently. So things are not necessarily better, but you get more information because you can look up more things and you can arm yourself with information.
But there's no way to get into that hospital
unless
you go through Hades.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Well, she finally gets in, and they're all filled up in the female part of the hospital, and she's put into urology.
Right. She gets a room prior to her surgery in a man's room. Right. It's just more of the complications and the insanity of medical care. Right.
And the operation is done. She comes, but I love too, with the husband is there with her, and she's like, don't let me go, don't make me go. And who hasn't felt that?
Right, well, he's gonna go home and watch 60 Minutes, and she's gonna go be eviscerated. So it's not gonna be fair, right?
She comes back out, and she shares the room with Garcia.
Oh, yes. She has a wonderful Spanish roommate who has her own TV, and our heroine doesn't have a TV. She waits for all the time that she's in the hospital to get this TV. And this young woman, who has already got six children, wants her tubes blown open so she can have 16. And that's why she's there. So there's a comic aspect to
but
that.
But not only does she have that and a husband, he is killed while she's there. And the family comes to mourn with her and say, but wait a minute. He's got a single brother.
You'll marry him, right? Yeah. And it will continue. And I mean, it isn't a kind book. There's a lot of satire and a lot of hostility, which I don't mean to be taken in a mean way, but it's, you know, when her husband dies, people come and bring her all kinds of flowers, and her relatives take them out in front of the hospital so they can sell them to other visitors. You know, there's just... It's higher and higher. It takes leaps and leaps of imagination.
And the nurses aren't that friendly. And finally, they're giving her shots to knock her out because she is what they call a complainer.
Yeah. Well, then, do you recall that she begins to get obscene phone calls from
Dr. Nickelodeon.
Dr. Nickelodeon. There happens to be someone in the hospital who hides in the lower hallways, and he knows what all the women's surgeries have been. And he's a little crazy. He's disturbed, and he calls various women who've had these surgeries and asks them how their different parts are. And our heroine happens to work on a hotline, and she's very familiar with men of this type who use the phones to satisfy their needs. And so she tries to counsel him. And the police come in and they understand that she's getting these phone calls and they want to move her out. And she says, don't get so excited. It's, you know, it's just a masturbator on the other end. Don't worry about it. So many things happen during her incarceration in the hospital. And many of them are funny and many of them are tragic. And then, of course, later she comes to find out that she knows Jeffrey and he knows her.
And she also suddenly feels a lump on her breast. Mm-hmm. And the Dr. Jeffrey, before she can even say hello, has in her head, she has him doing a complete mastectomy. And he comes in and does a little operation in her bed where he's using an assistant to do the real work, sort of a training program.
Yes, that often happens, right. There's always the surgeon and the surgeon's assistant who often gets to do the real thing. But while she's under this, you know, she's on a table and she has this steel thing over her breast on which they're putting instruments, she looks under this steel table and sees a blob of bubble gum.
Yep.
In other words, there are moments that the least thing that you expect to happen will happen.
Yep.
And it just changed. It's not a hospital novel. It's not an operation novel. It's a comic. It's a show. It's very different from
Meryl,
any novel.
What I would say is, if somebody hands you lemons, you're making lemonade in this book.
I sure do.
Yeah.
And had a very good time doing it. I mean, I laughed a lot writing this book. As you know, the heroine has three daughters, and each of the daughters has one more bizarre boyfriend after another, right? One is a Marine who chews bubble gum, and one is...
Well, he also is bisexual.
Yes. Well,
yeah.
They have it. In other words, every mother with daughters or sons dreads or fears what will be brought home on the hands of the children. And in this one, I let out all the stops, you know.
How close is that to anybody you know bringing home?
Well, you know, I have three daughters, and I bless them all. They all have good families, and they have children, and we have five grandchildren now. But along the way, there were some surprises, and there were some great worries. And I just thought this is the moment to blow it all out as far as I could.
Now, number two daughter brings home, after having all sorts of other types of men, brings home a Hasidic Jew.
Okay, this is this is where I may find some heavy-duty criticism. I mean, I'm a Jewish writer. I'm a Jew and I'm an American, but I write about Jewish families. And she meets this Chabad van driver with all these rules on top of the van about how, you know, when you do things and how you do things and how proper you should be. And the mother is quite horrified that, though she would have liked her daughter to bring home a nice Jewish boy.
A doctor's good.
Yeah. Here comes this very sour, angry, over-the-top religious boy who, when a neighbor gives our heroine some raspberries from her backyard, this man looks at them and dumps them on the ground and stomps on them and said they may not be kosher.
Where you got that and did that, I go,
good,
yeah.
Good. But you see, there's also a very over-the-top bar mitzvah in the latter part of the book, excuse me.
And that is where she decides Laura's rich little Beverly Hills boy does not need another $100 gift. And one of the nurses says to her, listen, go to Kmart. They got good plastic catcher's mitt. It'll do them good.
Right.
Well,
yeah.
When she presents it to this boy, he says, I wouldn't open that.
Or he puts it in the discard box, right. Does that say Kmart on it? But and also that bar mitzvah, you know, it's the type in which there's a giant sculpture in chopped liver of Moses. You know, the kind of bar mitzvah that brings itself to laugh at. And I just fear that I've been accused of making fun of serious Jewish practices.
Don't worry. Today, front page, New York Times, is about how the rabbis, the reform, are getting together to stop this sort of over-top, over-expenditure type bar mitzvah.
Really? Well, they can be insane. And, you know, and then there's the families who have the bar mitzvah here, and then they go to the Wailing Wall and have one, and then they have one in New York. I totally respect the traditions of the old world. I live in a different world right now, and I don't participate in those extreme rituals. And I can't help but see them in a way that seems very exaggerated and ridiculous to me at times.
Mm-hmm.
But But I still don't want to take the heat for being anti-Semitic in any way. That's not the truth at all.
All right. It's just within your own group you can make that sort of statement in a book.
Yes, you can. And as a writer, you can do just about anything and take the hits that come.
Now, the youngest daughter, her boyfriend, he's something else.
Oh, he's the one who trains the birds, you mean?
He's carrying a falcon on his bird.
A falcon. Yes. Well, I mean, all three of the girls, one of them falls in love with a guy who manages a casino in Las Vegas, you know, and he rides up on, he's a white guy on a black horse. And instead of the black guy on a white horse, in other words, there's always some fantasy involved in each of the children's. And I was very careful to make sure that none of these men really resembled the men that I was seeing my own daughters
marry
when they date, at least in those days. But you have to have fun about it because you're terrified. Nobody knows.
But she has a moment of great success. It is the fantasy of any woman who had a hysterectomy and wasn't too sure that the doctor wasn't saying this because he wanted to buy a new boat.
Well, and there's another very important aspect of this. Hysterectomy can really change a woman's sexuality, and that was not very much discussed 33 years ago. It is much better known today. Certain things are removed from your body which change your body's responses. And there's a group in this book called the Hysterectomy Hotline Group, a group of women who get together to discuss their losses, the way they have suffered since their hysterectomies, what physical things are not there for them, what yearnings, what emotions.
Is there such a group?
No.
Oh.
No. But there should be. And of course, right now, if you go online and look up hysterectomy chat groups, there are hundreds online. There are women who discuss what things, what happenings, what drugs, what changes they've experienced. It's much more open now. And of course, there's so many women gynecologists, and there are many more treatments. They don't necessarily always eviscerate a woman who has an ovarian cyst, for example.
I mean, this doctor does terrible. He doesn't do what is called a bikini cut. Was sewing
he
on her.
He didn't know from that, right?
Yeah.
He just takes everything.
And then when she goes to that bar mitzvah party, who should be there without a date but the doctor?
Right, he's sitting alone at a table. They're serving stuffed kishka to that table. He suddenly finds this woman quite attractive. He doesn't know who she is, but he starts making some moves on her. And she sees here's a possibility for some revenge.
Well, and she gets that revenge, and the fact that he acted like a baby about it.
Yes. Well, she has a neighbor who, it turns out, practices voodoo. And, of course, again, this is another of the exaggerations in the book. And one day when he has visited her in her examining room, she notices that he has a stick pin that's left in his shirt, and she pulls it out. The heroine pulls it out, and then she has a piece of his personal belongings, which she then gives to the voodoo neighbor and asks her to put a curse on him. And so there's a whole section there, which is very funny, about how this curse is
And go
rendered.
Into his office?
Right, right.
Yeah.
She goes to his office. Well, she makes an... He would like to have an affair with her now that he's interested in her. And she says, well... I can't take any risks of pregnancy. He doesn't even know she was his patient. And she agrees to have him have a vasectomy. So it's very, very complicated and convoluted.
But funny. But funny. But sweet is when she leaves the hospital, and I'm going to ask you to read that part.
Okay.
And it begins here, and if you'll just read that part, and on the next page.
Okay. Right. After her surgery, she and her husband decide they're going to take a vacation and leave the children behind and go and celebrate her survival. On the way to Las Vegas, my husband veered off the I-15 north and took a turn into I-40 east toward Bullhead City and Laughlin. He said he'd heard we'd get a better deal for our money in Laughlin, a great place for gambling. Food was said to be cheaper, slots were looser, and he'd never cared much for Caesar's Palace anyway. He promised me a room with a river view and a boat ride on the Colorado River. The sun was setting behind us, sending deep purple and pink rays into the sky and lighting the road as we sped toward our future. My husband laid out some plans. He thought we might renew our marriage vows on the River Belle, a 600-foot replica of a 19th-century paddle-wheeler boat. We could water ski, we could ride horses into the hills, or we could, here he lowered his voice and whispered, stay in our room and make love till the cows come home. My heart melted at the sweetness in his vision, at his trust in the renewed love life he felt was ahead of us, and at his romantic innocence. In truth, I had the gambler's vein of reckless abandon in my blood, and I suspected that once I hit the slot machines, he would have to pull me bodily from their clanging allure. Because I did not jump so eagerly at his suggestion about cows coming home, he softened his invitation by offering other possible attractions of the area. A bluegrass festival, a rock and gem show, a senior Olympics, a rodeo of 40 wild bulls being ridden by cowboys, a rockets over the river fireworks display, or the spectacle of 60,000 motorcyclists roaring down the river road. I feared my daughter's former motorcycle boyfriend might be among them. My husband said he wanted to do whatever would please me. I dozed while he tore across the desert, and when we reached the Colorado Riverboat Hotel, I let him carry our bags up to the room, while at the cashier's window I changed an old traveler's check from my wallet into 800 quarters, dumped them into a plastic bucket, and hit the slots. I knew I was now face to face with luck. It was here that I would finally learn if I were a lucky woman. Was I, for example, as lucky as Doctor's wife with the gold buckles on her shoes? As lucky as Laura with her three sons in her condominiums? Or could it be that I was plain and simple, a loser in life, a woman who had achieved no great heights or fame, who had never been a great beauty or a great genius or even a great business person? How did one measure a lucky life? At home, my three daughters, unchaperoned and unprotected, could be making critical decisions about their boyfriends or their hairdos that would affect their luck in life forevermore. Upstairs in our hotel room, my husband might be planning a blackjack strategy that at the tables could win or lose him a fortune. I chose a slot machine that blinked its invitation to me with a flashing sign that said, "Are you a lucky duck?" And I inserted my first three quarters. The wheels spun and I stopped worrying about life's larger questions. Mm-hmm. All that mattered were the three sevens which would or which would not line up on the payoff line.
I love it. I love it.
And then
the last part where you are dancing with him and you say, the only thing I ever wanted to let, will you dip me?
Okay, this is right here. Okay. This is when they're just leaving the house for Las Vegas. As soon as we hit the straightaway, my husband pulled me close against him, steering as in the old days with one hand on the Lucite steering knob. He headed across the desert at 90 miles an hour. We toasted one another with goblets of sparkling Manischewitz wine. When he turned on the music, the strains of our favorite song from the 50s, Hold Me, Thrill Me, Kiss Me, filled our little enclosed capsule. When the chorus came around for the third time, my husband stepped out of the car into the warm desert wind and held out mm-hmm. his hand. Dearest girl, no. May I have this waltz?
Yeah.
I reminded him gently that he had never learned to dance. He reminded me that in our long life together, we had overcome many setbacks and nothing would stop us now. Then I'd be honored to waltz with you, I said, accepting his hand and moving gracefully into his embrace. But will you be daring this one time and dip me? All my life, I have wanted to be dipped by you.
Bravo. Will you autograph my book?
Thank you.
And thank you, Meryl. And let me make a note. Take a look at the cover. Our author is also an artist. She painted the cover of this book. You've been seeing it throughout the show. recognize it now. But support your local library. Wherever you go, libraries are our most important democratic institution. And truly, you've got to have a library, but support it. And visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com or on YouTube, where you'll be able to see this show played again and again. But whatever you do, support that library and take a child with you. Learn how to read to them, and they will never forget you. So what better legacy can you leave? And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much,
thanks,
Meryl.
Thanks, dear.